Good morning, Red Cedar Church family, and welcome. If you're here visiting with us for the first time in this digital space, I want to say welcome on behalf of all of us here at Red Cedar. My name's Matt, I'm one of the pastors here, and wherever you come from, with regard to your church background and whatever you believe about Jesus or God, we're glad that you're here with us this morning. We believe that none of us are here by accident. And so I want to greet all of us here in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Happy Easter. Today there are many things that we can't see clearly. We can't see how this coronavirus is going to end. We can't see what the new normal will be like. And we can't see how we and our loved ones will be affected by it before this is all over. This morning, you and I can't even see each other. But our call to worship turns our attention to one who, in some sense, we can see right now. It turns our eyes to Jesus, the one that we can see because of the word about him passed from generation to generation and because of the way that he's worked to show what God is like. Our call to worship comes from Hebrews chapter 2, and it says this: "At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him, but we see him who for a little while was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone." And it goes on to say, that since we share in flesh and blood, Jesus himself partook of the same things so that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. And so this morning, even though we can't see clearly, we stand and say, our hope is in Jesus, the one who has set us free from death. He is risen. Would you join us in song?
Let's join our voices together this morning, praising our risen Savior.
I believe in the Son, I believe in the risen One, I believe I overcome by the power of His blood. Amen. Because He lives, every fear is gone.
Good morning, boys and girls. It's so good to see you this Easter morning. This Holy Week, Jesus has journeyed into Jerusalem and then to the cross where he died for you and me. Today, we get to celebrate his resurrection when he came back to life again. Our story today from the Jesus Storybook Bible is called God's Wonderful Surprise. And it's taken from the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Jesus' friends were sad. They would never see their best friend again. How could this happen? Wasn't Jesus the rescuer, the king God had promised? It wasn't supposed to end like this. Yes, but whoever said anything about the end? Just before sunrise on the third day, God sent an earthquake and an angel from heaven. When the guards saw the angel, they fell down in fright. The angel rolled the huge stone away, sat on top of it, and waited. At the first glimmer of dawn, Mary Magdalene and other women headed to the tomb to wash Jesus' body. The early morning sun slanted through the ancient olive trees, drops of dew glittering on leaves and grasses, like little tears everywhere. The friends walked quietly along the hilly path through the olive groves until they reached the tomb, and immediately noticed something very odd. It was wide open. They peered through the opening into the dark tomb. But wait, Jesus' body was gone. And something else, a shining man was there with clothes made from lightning. "Don't be scared," the angel said. But they couldn't help. And they said, they screamed. The angel asked, "What are you doing here? This is a tomb, and tombs are for dead people." The woman couldn't speak. "Jesus isn't dead anymore," he said. "He's alive again." And their hearts leapt. And then the angel laughed with such gladness that they felt for a moment as if they had woken from a nightmare. The other women rushed home, but Mary stayed behind. How could it be true? Jesus was definitely dead. How could he be alive? Just then, Mary heard someone else in the garden. "Perhaps it's the gardener," she thought. "He'll know where Jesus' body is." "I don't know where Jesus is," Mary said urgently. "I can't find him." But it was all right. Jesus knew where she was. And he had found her. "Mary." Only one person said her name like that. She could hear her heart thumping. She turned around. She could just make out a figure. She shaded her eyes to see and thought she was dreaming. But she wasn't dreaming. She was seeing Jesus. Mary fell to the ground, Sudden tears filled her eyes and great sobs shook her whole body. And all she wanted in that moment was to cling to Jesus and never let him go. "You'll be able to hold on to me later, Mary," Jesus said gently, "and always be close to me. But now, go tell the others that I am alive." Mary ran and ran all the way to the city. She had never run so fast or so far in all her life. She felt she could have run forever. She didn't even feel like her feet touched the ground. The sun seemed to be dancing and gleaming and bouncing across the sky, racing with her and shining brighter than she could ever remember in the clear, fresh air. And it seemed to her that morning as she ran, almost as if the whole world had been made anew. Almost as if the whole world were singing for joy. The trees, tiny sounds in the grass, the birds, her heart. Was God really making everything sad come untrue? Was he making even death come untrue? She couldn't wait to tell Jesus' friends. "They won't believe it," she laughed. She was right, of course. So let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for this Easter morning. Thank you that we get to celebrate together Jesus coming back to life again. Thank you, Jesus, for being our rescuer and our King and our Savior. Please help us tell others that you are alive. In Jesus' name, amen.
He has risen. He is risen indeed. Hello, I'm Jeff Rechtenwald. I'm on the elder team here at Red Cedar. I want to welcome you to Red Cedar Church this Easter Sunday as we celebrate Jesus' triumph over sin and death and look forward to the restoration of all things. We believe that Jesus' death and resurrection was the first step in fixing a broken world. We are a people defined by faith in the unique power of Jesus to forgive us and to restore our relationship with God. He has promised us that all who follow him in joy and suffering on this earth will follow him in a physical, glorious resurrection. This morning, as we talk with God through prayer, we honor him for his greatness. We ask that the restoration of this creation be soon. We seek his mercy and grace in our physical and emotional needs. And we pray that his kingdom would grow through our hearts, as well as through the addition of people who have turned from darkness into God's glorious light. Let's go ahead and pray. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. And to him who sits on the throne, be blessing and honor, glory and might forever and ever. Oh God, on this Easter Sunday, we praise you for your work that you accomplished 2,000 years ago. Thank you for dying on the cross to pay the penalty for our sins. Thank you for raising Jesus from the dead and for the promise of eternal life in perfect harmony with you in a perfect creation. Father, we long for the restoration of your creation. Daily we see the effects of sin and selfishness alienating us from one another. But ultimately, these things alienate us from you. Jesus, return to us soon. End the suffering. Bring about ultimate peace and joy. This is our earnest hope and our prayer. But should you delay, we know, Father, that it's so that people here have the opportunity to repent and to join your family. We pray that in these difficult times, that more people would turn and put their hope in you, the keeper of promises. May these dark times allow people to see your light even more clearly and to see the truth of your good news. We pray that your kingdom would reign in our lives, that we would die daily to self, to fear, and to worry, so that we are able to love you and love our neighbors even more perfectly. We pray that we would remember you are in control and your will cannot be thwarted. Thank you, God, for that. Father, we pray for our country, our state, our county, our city. We pray for wisdom for doctors, for leaders, for our governor, for our president and their advisors. We thank you that you have given us creative minds so that scientists and doctors can work on cures. We pray for their success and for their safety. For those of us who are sick, please grant us physical endurance and a speedy recovery. For those of us who are lonely, please grant us a sense of your presence in our lives. And for those of us who are healthy, grant us safety and courage. God, you are a good God. We believe that. We rejoice in it. Send us out in your goodness to serve our neighbors in joy. Be present in our praise this morning and be with us as we go out this week. Amen.
Let's join together once more in worship through song.
How can it be the one who died has borne our sins through sacrifice to conquer every sting of death? Sing, sing hallelujah. For joy awakes as dawning light when Christ's disciples lift their eyes. Alive he stands, their friend and king. Christ, Christ, he is risen. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Oh, sing hallelujah. Join the chorus, sing with the redeemed. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Where doubt and darkness once have been, they saw him and their hearts believed. But blessed are those who have not seen yet. Sing hallelujah. Once bound by fear, now bold in faith, we preach the truth and power of grace. And pouring out their lives, they gain life, life everlasting. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Oh, sing hallelujah. Join the chorus, sing with the redeemed. Christ is risen, he's risen indeed. The power that raised him from the grave now works in us to powerfully save. He frees our hearts to live his grace. Go tell of his goodness. Christ is risen, he's risen indeed. Oh, sing hallelujah. Join the chorus, sing with the redeemed. Christ is risen, he's risen indeed. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Oh, sing hallelujah. Join the chorus, sing with the redeemed. Christ is risen, he's risen indeed. He's alive, he's alive. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive, he's alive. Now in heaven glorified, he's alive, he's alive. Heaven's gates are open. He's alive, he's alive. Now in heaven glorified, he's alive. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Oh, sing hallelujah. Join the chorus, sing with the redeemed. Christ is risen, he's risen indeed. Christ is risen, he's risen indeed. Christ is risen, he's risen indeed.
Good morning. Our Resurrection Sunday scripture reading is taken from John chapter 12, verses 20 through 26. Now among those who went up to worship at the feast were some Greeks. So these came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and asked him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. And Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me, and where I am, there will be my servant also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him."
Good morning, Red Cedar and friends of Red Cedar. He is risen, and I can hear all of you saying, "He is risen indeed." I'm here this morning in my traditional Easter outfit, but this is clearly not a traditional Easter morning. It goes without saying that this is an Easter like we've never experienced before, and I hope never experience again. And yet, in one sense, we as a human race have never been more isolated than ever before. Yet, ironically, we're also more bonded together, if I can put it that way, more unified than ever before. There are all kinds of moving stories of heroes and hope that remind us that we are one human race together fighting this invisible enemy. And yet there's been a lot of attention on so many people dying, which has made me hope for and pray for that the message of Easter will be heard like never before. This is the time of year that we call spring in the northern half of the world. And there's been a very familiar historic parallel between spring and Easter. Spring is a time when out of barren ground comes life, when out of death something blossoms. And that is exactly what the message of Easter is all about. So join me as we pray for our world to hear this message, not just us here today, this morning, but so many churches all around this planet. Father, we are asking and even looking with anticipation to you that we might hear this very familiar message for many of us, this message of Jesus, his death and his resurrection, against the backdrop of this very unique moment in history. May it be that we hear this message like never before. You are the one who brings out of death life that can never die again. Speak to us now. Speak to many millions throughout this world, we pray. In the risen name of our Savior Jesus. Amen. Well, last week we looked at the story from Palm Sunday of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And in the Gospel of John, there are four Gospels that make up the New Testament, these four authorized biographies of Jesus. And in the Gospel of John, we see this rather seemingly insignificant detail that's placed in the storyline right after Jesus' spectacular entry into Jerusalem. Now, if you think about it, many things happened during Jesus' last week in Jerusalem. And John could have picked all kinds of things to place there. But John picks a detail that seemingly is, again, as I mentioned, insignificant in the storyline. Let me read it for you. You've already heard it read once, but let's go over it again. John chapter 12, verse 20. "Now among those who went up to worship at the feast were some Greeks." And just as a footnote here, these weren't actually people from the country of Greece. These were people from the Greek-speaking world. Most of the European and Middle East world at that time spoke the Greek language, and these were excuse me, primarily non-Jews called Gentiles. So the Jews spoke Hebrew, but here the common trade language was Greek. And so here were some non-Jews, some Gentiles, coming to Jerusalem to worship at the feast. In other words, they were coming to celebrate the Jewish Passover. There were many Gentiles who had converted to the Jewish faith, and they were from the Greek-speaking world, and they came here for this festival. And so we're told in verse 21, they come to Philip, who is from Bethsaida, I always struggle with that word, in Galilee, and they asked him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." So Philip went and told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. And then something very unusual happens, something that's meant to feel abrupt. Let's look at the next verse. "And Jesus answered them, 'The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified.'" Now that doesn't seem to make sense. We would kind of expect Jesus to say, "Well, tell them I'll talk to them later," or "Tell them this isn't their time to listen to me," or "Tell them to come here." There's lots of options that would have made sense. Suddenly it seems like Jesus is completely switching the subject, and yet he's also addressing the subject. Something happened in these Greek-speaking people, these Gentiles coming to see Jesus, that made Jesus say, "Now is my time. The hour has come." Several times in the Gospel of John, Jesus has been using this phrase, but every single time that he used it, he was always saying, "My hour has not yet come." So whatever these Greeks did, without realizing it, they sort of flipped the switch in all of human history, if I can put it that way. It's as though there were two rivers that were flowing together, and now they're coming to a convergence. Well, what were those two rivers? What's going on here? Well, let's look at another passage, one we saw together when we were taking our journey through the book of Romans. In Romans chapter 10, verse 20, Paul says this, "I have been found by those who did not seek me. I have shown myself to those who did not ask for me." Now, Paul's actually quoting from a part of the Bible that was written 700 years before Jesus. And this is God speaking, and God says, "People who I never sought out, who I never went after and did special favors for them like I've done the Jews, those people are finding me. People who I haven't revealed myself to are curious, and they're seeking me out." But the passage goes on to say in verse 21, "But of Israel, he says, 'All day long I've stretched out my hand to a disobedient and contrary people.'" So two things are happening in human history. Centuries and centuries have passed where God has been, in a sense, stretching his hand out to the Jews who've been consistently rejecting him. And now, in a sense, by rejecting Jesus and plotting to kill him, they have cemented their rejection. At the same time, Gentiles have been on the fringes, and their numbers have been increasing. And they're like firewood that's just waiting for the spark of a match to explode into a worldwide awakening of followers of Jesus. And these two things are coming together now by two things happening. Right before Jesus comes into Jerusalem, the Jewish leaders plot to kill him. And right after he comes into Jerusalem, a bunch of Gentiles are seeking him out. And Jesus says, "The hour has come." Which leads to an important observation, not the main point. I'm going to give just two helpful observations before we get to the main point of this message. The first one is this: behind history is his story. Behind the curtain of day-to-day events and even big crises, his story is unfolding. And God's word is like are like night vision goggles. When we spend time in God's word, we see movement behind the darkness of the past. We're able to look into the past where we didn't see something before, and with God's word, we're able to see what's going on. We're able to see the profound behind the insignificant. We're able to see the profound even behind the terrible. And that's what's happening here as John looks back now and remembers this encounter and remembers these words that Jesus said. In fact, if you want another interesting example of this, sort of a homework assignment this next week, read the chapter that comes right before this, John chapter 11. There's a story there about two sisters who reach out to Jesus. Their brother, Lazarus, is on his deathbed. He's very sick. They send word to Jesus, who's a little ways away, and say, come quickly. They know he can heal him. But Jesus intentionally delays. And what happens here in this story is God doesn't intervene. Jesus doesn't intervene, and things actually get worse. But it sets the stage for a greater peek behind the curtain. It sets the stage for Jesus to not just say something, but to prove something. It's in this chapter, John chapter 11, where Jesus makes these famous words, says these famous words, "I am the resurrection and the life." Now, even his closest followers didn't really understand what that meant and didn't really believe that Jesus could raise someone from the dead after they'd been dead 4 days. But if Jesus had not delayed, this great moment would have not happened. So whether it's a dreaded crisis where God doesn't seem to be intervening as quickly as we'd like him to, or just ordinary day-to-day events, they're all choreographed into this grand drama where everything serves the King of all kings. Now, this verse goes on to say the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. What does it mean to be glorified? Well, the word can mean to be honored or to be lifted up. It's as though Jesus is saying, and it's not as though, he actually is saying this, this is my crowning moment. This is the moment when I'm going to be crowned king. So how will Jesus be honored? How will he be exalted? Well, the next verse tells us how. Truly, truly, I say to you. Now, whenever Jesus uses this phrase, it's like he's saying, listen up, of all the things I've been telling you, this is in bold. This is important. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. So once again, I think there's an interesting observation to make here before we comment on what Jesus is getting at there. And it's this: creation is constantly pointing us toward recreation. I think both of these observations are helpful during this kind of strange place we find ourselves at right now in the world. But if you look around, you can constantly see examples of life coming out of death. And here Jesus gives us another one. It's as though he's saying there are hints all around us in the world that more is going on than what we can see and touch. That we as human beings are more than just the natural causes of natural laws. That just as life springs out of death in the spring into something that's blooming, so every seed must be buried before it can blossom. And Jesus, I think, is remembering a passage here, and so is John who wrote this, a passage that's very common this time of year that was written 700 years before Jesus, the passage in Isaiah chapter 52, and extending all the way into chapter 53. Listen to what this says. Behold my servant, this is Isaiah 52 verse 13, behold my servant shall act wisely, he shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. Jesus just said, this is my hour to be glorified, to be exalted. But then something surprising in this passage written so long ago. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So apparently, the way that Jesus is going to be glorified, the way God's servant is going to be exalted, is through some kind of brutal punishment where he won't even look like a human being. And then notice this last line, which has been confusing to interpret at different times. So shall he sprinkle many nations. So three things. God has a servant. He's going to lift him up and crown him through a brutal process that will result in all the nations being sprinkled, all the nations being cleansed. In one sense, it's really a rather gruesome picture that's being painted here in Isaiah with amazing and profound results. So it's exaltation by execution. It's being lifted up by being struck down, which leads me to the main point of the message this morning. Burial is how we blossom for God. Jesus, interestingly, Jesus doesn't stop at verse 24. He goes on and tells us in verses 25 and 26 that the same is going to be true for you. Just as I have to be buried in order to blossom, so you have to be buried like this seed in order to blossom. And I want you to notice, first of all, verse 26. If anyone serves me, he must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. In a sense, Jesus is saying, my path is your path. As with me, so with you. Jesus took up his cross, and he tells us in another passage, so you must take up your cross. We too, if we want to follow Jesus, then we have to follow Jesus into burial as well, so that we can bear fruit. Now, before you think this is some kind of call to poverty, or some kind of that following Jesus is making yourself suffer. And sadly, in the history of the Christian church, there have been many people who thought they're closer to God if they actually inflict themselves with all kinds of suffering. And before we judge those strange people who actually took whips and whipped themselves till they bled, you know, we can do the same thing. We can beat up on ourselves because we're never good enough for God. We can never keep his law like we'd like to. And we somehow think that the path to holiness, to following Jesus, is to deny ourselves all these wrong kinds of things and to beat up on ourselves. But that's not what's being communicated here. In fact, look at verse 25. Whoever loves his life loses it. Whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for life eternal. What Jesus is saying is, I'm not telling you to follow me into burial and make your life miserable. What I'm telling you is that if you want to know what real life is, you need to get buried first. If you want to know what real life is, you got to quit holding on to your life. Notice these phrases in this verse. First of all, there's a contrast between loving and hating. Jesus says it in a very provocative way. He wants to get our attention. And he's not telling us to hate ourselves here. He's saying if we should think of the word as love and hate as two strong opposites. When we love something, we cling to it, and when we hate something, we are refusing it. So he's saying there's a kind of way that we lose our life by clinging to it, and there's kind of a way that we keep it by actually resisting it. So let me explain that a little more clearly. When he says loving our life, what he means is when we are ruled by just our own spirit, then we wind up living a life of self-preservation and self-promotion. But if we hate our life, in other words, if we're ruled by Jesus' spirit, then we have the ability to deny ourselves and choose sacrifice. And the amazing thing is that when we go in that path, we actually wind up experiencing life. We'll unfold this a little bit more. But I want you to see one more thing before we get to our sort of application point this morning. Verse 26 also says, if anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. So another way to think of this is we can either live for the Father's honor, which is not only lasting, but it's also an honor that comes to us later, usually after we die. We can either live for the Father's honor or we can live for human honor. And if you've lived long in this world, one thing you know about human honor, human applause, human affirmation, human respect, is that it's short-lived even in this world. So if burial is how we blossom for God, then this is the other point to be made along with it. If burial is how we blossom for God, then the fear of death keeps us from experiencing life. That's sort of the opposite way of saying it. And I want to bring in another passage of scripture here that will explain that. If Jesus is calling all of his followers to be like him, the seed that gets buried so that it might bear more fruit, then another way of saying that is the fear of death keeps us from experiencing this very life that Jesus is calling us to. Listen to these two verses in Hebrews chapter 2. Because God's children are human beings, in other words, made of flesh and blood, the Son of Man became flesh and blood. For only as a human being could he die, and only by dying could he break the power of the devil, who had the power of death. Only in this way could he set free all who have lived their lives as slaves to the fear of dying. Now, there are two points that are being made here. In the first couple of phrases here, Jesus, we're being told in this book of Hebrews, that Jesus became one of us to die like us. Because he was more than us, his death killed death for us. I know that's a loaded phrase, let me just say it one more time. Jesus became one of us so that he could die like us. But because he was more than us, his death killed death for us. Again, we'll say a little bit more about what it means that he killed death for us. But that's what these first two sort of paragraphs here say. But then I want you to notice this last sentence. Only in this way could he set free all who have lived their lives as slaves to the fear of death. Now, it says the devil has the power of death. That doesn't mean that the devil can kill us, because only God ultimately decides when every human being is born and when every human being is die. So what does it mean that the devil has the power of death? Well, I think this last phrase really helps us figure this out. What he has is he preys on our fear of dying, and he uses that to enslave us, to control humanity. Now, you might be saying, like I have at different times, well, but I'm not afraid of dying. And you might be saying, well, I'm a believer, so I'm not afraid of dying. And I'm one of those people that I feel like even before I became a believer, I really wasn't afraid of dying. Now, by the way, important footnote, it's real easy to say you're not afraid of dying when you're not facing death. So I don't know if I'm not afraid of dying. I just assume I am. But this isn't speaking about just the fear of physically dying here, because after all, what does it say in this passage? This is a power that the devil has over all of humanity. So it's speaking about a fear of death here that is more than physical death. Maybe another way of saying this that could be helpful, it's the fear of losing. This is what the devil does. He preys upon our fear of losing what we believe is our life. He preys upon the fear of losing what we believe or what we consider to be life. And it's also helpful to understand that death in the Bible never means end of something. Death in the Bible never means end of something. Death in the Bible means separation. So in Genesis chapter 3, God tells Adam and Eve, when you eat of this fruit, you will die. And so they ate of the fruit, and guess what? They didn't physically die, but they were separated from the rich life that God intended for them. Or think of 1 Corinthians 15 when it speaks about physical death. It speaks about it not as the end of life, but as the separation of the body from the soul. Again, death isn't the end of something, it's the separation of something. And so when Jesus says in John chapter 10, I've come that you might have life and might have it abundantly, He's offering us something that will well up within us and overflow. As opposed to an opposite idea of abundant life is found in Romans chapter 1. Whereas humanity continues to resist and resist God, we're told in Romans chapter 1 that God withdraws from humanity. And as he withdraws from humanity and leaves them to their self, it goes on to describe that what human beings do then is they destroy one another. So we could put it this way. The closer we are to God, the more life is overflowing out of us, and the farther we're separated from God, the more life is leaking out of us, the more we're bound for self-destruction. So this idea here of the fear of death is the fear of losing what we consider as life. So let me give just a few examples of that. The fear of physical dying is really the fear of losing the only thing that we know. It's because we believe this life is all there is. So that's what the fear of physical dying is. It's the fear of losing the only thing we know, this life. And it's because we believe behind that fear is the belief that this is really all there is. This is the only thing that's certain, that's known. What about the fear of losing a loved one? Well, the fear of losing a loved one is the fear of losing someone that has become our life, because we believe that there is no life without that person. What about the fear of losing a business or a career or a job? Well, that fear is the fear of losing what makes our life happy and rewarding and meaningful, because we believe behind that is the belief that life without work is life without purpose and power. See, behind all these fears is a picture of what we really think is life. We think this person we love is life. We think this life is the only life there is. We think this business or career or job is the only thing that can really give me worth and purpose and power. But it's not only the fear of losing something as a form of the fear of death, but there's also the fear of facing certain things that are unlivable in our mind. So not just the fear of losing something, the fear of death can also be the fear of facing something that's unlivable in our minds. So just a couple examples. People that face chronic physical pain, chronic mental illness, chronic relational illness. In other words, they're stuck in a relationship that for them is just miserable and they can't seem to get out of it. All of these, the sort of chronic hardships are like life leaking miseries. They make the fear of death very real. It's like death is hovering. And behind these is also a belief. Behind these, this fear of facing something unlivable is the belief that these are barriers. My chronic physical health, or I'm stuck in a bad relationship. What makes them unlivable is that we actually believe they're barriers between us and the good life, when in fact, they're actually burial pathways. They're not barriers between us and the good life. They're actually burial pathways to discover real life. A great example of that would be to read or listen to anything by Johnny Erickson Tada, who has spent most of her human existence in a wheelchair, and to realize that these things that could have become the fear of death leaking life out of her, actually things that she thought were unlivable, turned out to be burial pathways, if I can put it that way, ways to die to self and actually discover real life. Just one more example of facing something that's unlivable. Restlessness, or impatience, or uncertainty. I just sort of put all those things together because I think that's a common experience right now in this world of being stuck in our homes. Facing restlessness and impatience and uncertainty. can very naturally lead to substance abuse. And I'm not just talking about chemical substance abuse. We can abuse substances, other kinds of substances as well, like food and shopping online and entertainment. And we, part of the reason we do this is, again, because behind what gives the fear of death a foothold in our life are these beliefs that we have, what we consider to be really our life, which isn't. And in this case, the reason substance abuse gets a foothold on us is because we believe that rhythm and routine is our life. Rhythm and routine is our life. Rhythm and routine give us worth. They give us predictability. They give us productivity. They give us boundaries between work and play, and all of those things are gone right now. What we should be realizing right now is that there's a tendency for us to be addicted to this Peloton kind of rhythm where there's no space in our life to slow down and deeply reflect on what life is all about. And now suddenly God has given us space for that. So in other words, we're so busy keeping life that we're actually losing life. Hopefully these are helpful, the ways that the fear of death becomes very real in our life and very, very controlling. But the whole purpose of the Easter message is this. If the fear of death, the fear of losing what we believe is life, keeps us from experiencing real or eternal life, then the message of Easter is this: Jesus' death has killed death, and his resurrection empowers life. Now, let me be very clear about something. It's impossible to go through life not fearing death. It's impossible to go through life, not even as a believer, and not have this sort of fear of losing what we think is life get a foothold on us. After all, most of the things I mentioned a minute ago, work and loved ones and health, those are all God's blessings. Unfortunately, as human beings, even as human beings with the Spirit of God in us, unfortunately, we have a tendency to take God's blessings and turn them into substitutes for God himself. And the point here is this: Easter is all about what Jesus' death and resurrection does for you. God rescues us from keeping our life, that sort of self-preserving, self-promoting existence that ultimately leaves us emptier. God rescues us from that sort of keeping our life world. And Jesus has died to free us from that. And that helps, that keeps this fear of death from getting a foothold in our life. And he's raised us. Jesus, let me put it this way. Jesus died to free us from this enslaving fear of death. And he was raised to empower us to live a self-sacrificing, self-denying life so that abundant life can overflow out of us so that, like our master, we can choose burial so that we would blossom. So just some hopefully practical applications in the last couple of seconds here. How can we believe in Jesus' resurrection, or more specifically, instead of just believing in Jesus' resurrection, I want to experience Jesus' resurrection. I want that resurrection power to be alive and well in me and all of you. So, three simple words that I've tried to make memorable here: reduce, reset, and rejoice. I think we can reduce fear's footprint in our life. I think we can reduce this fear of death, this sort of holding on to what we think is life, but actually isn't. I think we can reduce it by a couple simple things: by memorizing, by singing, and by praying. Those are common disciplines of Christians all around the world. Memorizing, not just reading God's word, but actually thinking about it and actually maybe memorizing some of it, or singing it, or praying it. So I've been helped tremendously in the last week by thinking about Isaiah chapter 35, where God is able in the wilderness to turn the burning sand into a bubbling pool. it says in Isaiah 35. He's able to make the lame walk, the blind see. So just thinking about that, Lord, you are the God who can do this. And I've also been really blessed by a song by Andrew Peterson, which we'll close with in just a second. So we can reduce fear's footprint by memorizing and singing and praying death away. We can also have our life be reset during this time. Maybe this isn't and shouldn't be thought of as a life-threatening moment as the COVID-19 comes knocking on our doors. Maybe this isn't a life-threatening moment. Maybe instead this is a life-awakening moment. Maybe this is a time when God wants us to push the reset button on our life. Is there something you're clinging to? Something God has given to you as a blessing that is all in lower, it's life with lowercase letters, L-I-F-E, but we or you have turned it into life with capital letters, something you can't imagine life without? I would encourage you to go on a walk and interact with God and others about this. If you've got young kids around, then find a place for them to roam. Maybe where they don't roam with other kids, I'm not sure, but find a space in this sort of strange moment that we're in, and think out loud with God and others about this issue of, is there something you're clinging to, something you're afraid of losing that isn't actually your life itself? I know for me, one of the things I've been thinking about this last week or two has been goals. G-O-A-L-S, that's right, goals. I've realized that my life is way too programmed by goals, and I've been asking myself the question, why do I get so excited when they're accomplished, and why do I get so frustrated when most of the time they're not reached? And there's something about this goal-drivenness that isn't life, and I've been clinging to it too strongly. And finally, rejoice. Promises have been made to you. The promise, God has promised to rescue you from sin's penalty. He actually has already done that if you belong to Jesus. He's promising to, even now, he is rescuing you from sin's power, and he ultimately will rescue you from sin's presence. And that's all because Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Death and COVID-19 cannot stop this from coming true. I think more than any other time in my life, right now, prosperity and predictability, which I've wrongly labeled life, prosperity and predictability are being threatened. And one of the things I've noticed is that when prosperity and predictability are threatened, I think more about the promised land. But when I'm most of my life, those things have not been threatened, and I don't think that much about the promised land because, quite frankly, this land's good enough. But I think this is a golden moment for us to realize what life is all about. It's as though we can look past this uncertain time to a certain future, and it can be like a magnet that's pulling us toward the promised land. So with that, I want to close with just a few words here from Andrew Peterson's song, Rise Up. Peterson sings, every stone that makes you stumble and cuts you when you fall, every serpent here that strikes your heel to curse you when you crawl, the King of Love one day will crush them all. And every sad seduction and every clever lie, every word that woos and wounds the pilgrim children of the sky, the King of Love will break them by and by. And you will rise up in the end. You will rise up in the end. I know the night is cruel, but the day is coming soon when you will rise up in the end. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Let's pray. Oh, Father, we come to you in the name of your risen Son, our risen King, confident in the risen spirit of Jesus in our hearts now. I pray especially for those who might be listening this morning who really don't know what it means to have the risen Jesus living in their hearts. You have told us, don't be afraid of the one who can kill the body, but be afraid of the one who can put to death the body and the soul. So I do pray that you would awaken people to this unbelievable invitation to find real life by giving up the life we're holding on to so dearly. And we ask this now for the glory and increasing fame of our risen Savior's name. Amen.
Every stone that makes you stumble and cuts you when you fall, every serpent here that strikes your heel to curse you when you crawl, the King of Love one day will crush them all. And every sad seduction and every clever lie, every word that woos and wounds the pilgrim children of the sky, the King of Love will break them by and by, and you will rise up in the end. You will rise up in the end. I know the night is cruel, but the day is coming soon when you'll rise up in the end. If a thief had come to plunder when the children were alone,